Hello and a very warm welcome back to the garden. I've got a really special video for you today because it's all about how to be self-sufficient in salads all through the year. Rather than focusing on trying to be self-sufficient with one particular crop, this approach makes it so much easier to get the most from your garden and save you a lot of money. So firstly, a salad doesn't have to include lettuce in it. To paraphrase the Oxford Dictionary's definition of salad, it's a mix of either raw or cooked vegetables as a cold dish that is seasoned with either oil, vinegar, or another sort of dressing. Salad, the word itself, is a very broad description of something. It's all encompassing, just like a soup. There were hundreds, if not thousands, of different types of soup around the world. And we're gonna use this breadth and this potential diversity to our advantage to make it so much easier to be self-sufficient in salad all year. I think the real skill that you need in terms of salad self-sufficiency is to see recipes as sources of inspiration, but not a be-all and end-all. If you're missing a few ingredients, it doesn't mean that you can't make it. It's about understanding the base of what makes a good salad. And then using the principle of forage first, create later, which I think came from third plate. See what's in your garden, forage first, harvest what you need, and then using the basic principles of making a tasty salad, put it all together and enjoy. Foraging first and then creating later is also a very intuitive way of actually reducing food waste, because all you're doing is you're harvesting what you're going to eat. You're going to be cooking it right away. You don't need to worry about weights and quantities. I think when it comes to approaching salad making, you've got to make it fun and tasty. I don't like salads when I go to a cafe and they just give you a pile of lettuce leaves and maybe a bit of olive oil and vinegar. I think that's really boring. There's so much more to salads. They can be as simple as you want them. For me, nothing beats a potato, mayo, and chive salad, but also you can make it as complex and fun as possible with adding 40, 50 different ingredients if you wish. There's no limit, have fun, and make the most of what the garden has to offer. The other big benefit of this is you might only have a really small quantity of a particular crop that won't make enough for a portion for a meal, but it's more than enough to add into a salad. So even if you've only got a very small crop, you can still truly enjoy it. Technically, it's a hungry gap. We're in April and it's one of the most challenging times to eat from the garden. But I'm going to show you, using the following formula, which my colleague Sam has kindly shared, of showing you how to create a salad no matter what season it is. And it's about having a lot of fun. As long as you use this base formula to inspire you and to follow loosely, chances are you're going to have something delicious. So first off, you need to consider what the bulk ingredient. This could be something kind of starch-based like potatoes, it could be a root vegetable, or it could be something like leaves. That's kind of very often when we think of salads, it's a lot of leaves. Right now, what I'm thinking of is actually flowering shoots, like the ones behind me, but ones that are a little bit more bulky, like purple sprouting broccoli. The next element of the formula is just to build on top of what your bulk ingredient is. Think about what flavors or what harvests are in your garden that you might have much smaller quantities of, but will complement that bulk element. Then it's about aromatics. What is going to give that real boost and depth to the flavor and also the smell of your salad? Usually this is where herbs and also the alliums, for example, chives or onions or anything like that, come into the picture. This is what is going to really pack a lot of punch to your salad. The other thing to consider is texture. For example, you can have a raw crunch, or you could think about cooking it, such as char grilling, to soften it slightly but still have that crunch inside and start to add another layer of flavor there. You can also think about actually adding things that you've pickled. Next is sauce. And when we think about salad dressings, almost all of them are a combination of a fat and an acid. For example, olive oil and then apple cider vinegar. Another example is actually mayonnaise and yogurt. And focusing more on the fat side, fats hold aromatic compounds. So if you're thinking about the aromatics that you want to add in, whether it's something like alliums or herbs, often mixing these into the dressing is one of the best ways to boost the aromatics and really capture and carry that flavor throughout the salad. And the final slightly optional part of this formula is about adding a bit of color or a bit of magic. This usually means things such as edible flowers. They're not so much going to affect the flavor, they're more going to affect how visually stunning it is. And if you've got some edible flowers out there, add them on top of the salad and it just brings a little bit of magic to finish it off. So this very much links into what I've been saying about growing for flavor over productivity. As you can see, I've harvested some radish. I only had 5 that were of a harvestable size, but I can make use for them. I don't need like a dozen or 20 to try and pickle. I can put these 5 and they will fit in really nicely into the salad. This is our patch of wild garlic. It isn't really wild because it was planted here, but it's doing really well. And this is going to serve as the aromatic base to the salad that we're making. It's got such a lovely taste. And because it's growing and it's a fantastic crop for the hungry gap, it absolutely deserves a place in the salad. So using the formula for creating a salad, here's what I made using what's available in the garden and really trying to celebrate the purple sprouting broccoli by char grilling it. And char grilled or baked and also steamed are 3 great methods for cooking the cooked vegetable elements part of a salad, and it's so simple to make. And if you're looking for these kind of recipes that celebrate what comes out of the garden, the collaborative project that I'm doing with Sam called Farmer and Chef is quite a big selection now of recipes dedicated for what you can get from the garden. We've had a real big push on wild garlic recipes, so no doubt this might end up on that list of recipes as well. On this journey of being self-sufficient in salads all year, one thing I really recommend is just keep a note of certain combinations or flavors that you really enjoy. And you want to actually create your own personalized collection of perhaps go-to salads or seasonal salads that you enjoy, or if you want to replicate it again if you've got guests coming over next week. I'd also suggest that you really work on creating your signature dressing. Set yourself a challenge of creating some kind of dressing that you could maybe swap out the main aromatics, but just have fun with really making this about what suits you and your taste buds. The only real investment I can think of in order to help aid self-sufficiency in salads is some kind of undercover growing. You don't need to have a polytunnel hoop house or greenhouse. You could get something like a smaller grow house or a cold frame just to grow particular things that might not be quite as hardy. But failing that, there's a lot that you can grow to eat and enjoy over winter and the hungry gap. And this video here is going to give you 15 different crops to sow around this time of year to enjoy during basically the off season.